I'd have-
Do you remember the dagger you gave me?
The dagger stabbed into the Reaver's back? His own son killed him? Yeah, I haven't forgotten that one.
Well, I traced it to a group of Reavers that operate out of the Northree stronghold. I'd wager that's where they took their haul from Fafnir's storeroom, along with that whetstone that I could use to help you.
Another treasure hunt? Pointless.
Well, not if Sindri really can make us better equipment with that whetstone. Plus, the Reaver's son. He murdered his father.
Something down there. We can beach over here.
Come on!
I can't believe Odin and Freya were ever married.
Love and hate are more closely intertwined than you might imagine.
Enough. No stories. Not while on foot. Our focus is the road.
Completely understand. I'll finish later, lad.
Saying something about love and hate being
intertwined, yes. For instance, Odin hates the giants and they him. But Thor's own mother was the giantess Björgun, one of Odin's great loves.
So Thor's half god and half giant? Weird.
Once Björgun was gone, lonely ages passed for Odin. And as war with the Vanir raged, he could see what he really wanted beneath his bluster. And after no small amount of convincing, Freya agreed. For a while there, he really turned on the charm. He seemed happy. He seemed interested in making her happy. He granted her so many wishes, I can scarcely recall them all. The peace held, and I truly believed all had worked out better than I could have planned. But Odin's true face showed itself again in the end. Oh, he won Freya's trust, and she taught him some of her Vanir magic, another choice she would live to bitterly regret. Sadly, despite his wise counselor's best efforts to persuade him that peace was the only true path to stave off Ragnarok, Odin never let go of his obsession with Jotunheim. The taste of Vanir magic led him to new forms of experimentation and new levels of depravity.
Go!
Okay, obviously the marriage to Odin didn't last. But how did Frey end up a hermit in the woods?
Oh, that was a singular piece of cruelty, even for Odin. As if the marriage wasn't punishment enough. Freya was better to him than he deserved. She stuck it out through all manner of indignity, all in the name of maintaining peace and safety for her people. But Odin's madness, his tyranny, his corruption of her magics, it became more than she could stomach, and at long last she broke it off. Odin's wrath was fierce, and his curses upon her were more than she dared to fear.
But her magic was so much stronger than his.
After so much time together, he knew her vulnerabilities, and exploited them to craft curses she could never break.
Oh, like not being able to leave Midgard.
Worse still, he robbed her of her warrior spirit. Freya cannot fight, even to defend herself. No living thing may she harm by blade nor spell. In a world this belligerent, what choice does she have but isolation?
Poor Freya. I guess if I was her, I'd spit in your face too.
Aye, lad. So would I.
You want a beach here? I can read what this says now, but it's a name.
Rota! Whoa! The name made it light up!
It's the name of one of the Valkyries. That's quite curious.
This is where the tower to Jotunheim should be. Feels strange somehow.
No doubt some arcane magics were involved. I would be not at all surprised to learn you were sensitive to that.
Another name.
Gerdrifal.
Another Valkyrie. That's no coincidence. But who'd have etched them on Tyr's braziers?
There was a shrine about a giant lady with lots of books and visions.
Ah, that would be Groa, the Knowledge Keeper. She was a gifted sorceress who gathered every tome of arcane wisdom she could find in the realms, all in the hopes of augmenting her powers of prophecy that she might find her lost husband, Aurvandil. But it was not her husband she would glimpse in her visions. For it was Groa, seeing longer and farther than any before or since, who witnessed Ragnarok, the end and the beginning. When Odin caught word of her ultimate prophecy, he maneuvered to obtain her knowledge and hoard it for himself. Groa knew Odin as a longtime patron of her services, and so she welcomed him into her library as a friend. What she did not know is that Odin himself was behind her husband's disappearance, having used his enchantments to conceal his death at Thor's hands from her sight. Smiling, jealous Odin took her by the throat, and with his very hands he stole her library and her life for his own.
I always knew Odin was bad. That's just...
ruthless? Barbaric? Heartless? That's Odin. In fact, we would do well to sit here in silence for the next few moments and reflect on Odin's capacity for cruelty. And so...
reflect longer.
Roma!
Nice shot!
piece of the language cipher.
Good.
Tell me about that giant lady with the bow.
She was called Skadi, Queen of the Hunt. Her father was Thjotsi, who could take the shape of any wild creature, and taught Skadi how to hunt them all. From the ribs of pack beasts, she fashioned second feet, allowing her to glide upon the snow so no animal could evade her. She became a huntress beyond compare, even to any god. Odin himself wanted her for his bride, believing she would bear him strong sons. But she spurned his affections, and for that insult, Odin vowed revenge. It was put forth that the Aesir were plagued by an eagle who would steal the precious golden apples of Idun. Not even the finest archer among the gods could bring it down. Odin knew that Skadi could not resist the temptation to prove herself superior, and so she joined the hunt. Skadi tracked the eagle as it flew where she alone could glide, and loosed an arrow from her unerring bow. When she collected her quarry, she found no eagle at all, but her own father, poor Thjotsi, slain by his own daughter. She was overcome with grief and shame. For there is nothing nature so reviles as a child who kills their parent. Skadi succumbed to her fate as winter's blanket fell. Her father, as the mountain held her, in an embrace to last eternity.
Well, that was sad.
Aye. There aren't many happy endings for the giants, I'm afraid.
Reach the boat here. We're not getting in there without a key. I have a question. If Ymir was the first giant, where did he come from?
In the beginning, there was Ganungagap, the Great Void. There were no realms yet, only primordial forces. There was fire, and there was ice. And there in the void, they met and produced...
water?
More than water. The mystic lifeblood of something entirely new. From this water, Ymir took form and became a being of pure creation and chaos, mother and father to all that came after.
Even the Aesir?
Aye. Every god, man, and beast came first from Ymir's flesh. Though it was the Aesir who thought themselves so superior that they should hold dominion over the rest of creation. It was Odin, who took arms against his creator and spilled Ymir's lifeblood with his spear. A necessary evil, he would say, to bring order to the realms. Ymir's torn flesh, Odin would fashion the realm of Midgard for his own. Called himself All-Father as if he was the creator and not the creator's destroyer. The small, covetous tyrant.
Ymir?
Huh? Oh, sorry, my boy. You know, I think it best we just end it there, actually. Tyr's braziers, a symbol of the light that binds all realms together.
Why would he use those strange runes, though?
Now you mention it, he wouldn't.
We've seen these runes before, but it's the kind I still can't read.
Look here.
Yes, sir. Okay. That's going in the journal.
I can't translate this without the whole place.
Over though!
A dangerous beast. We will take him down together. Ed, you are full of stories. When will you tell one that entertains?
I beg your pardon?
You just insulted me.
Yeah, I got that. So you want a corker, do you? Very well, my brothers. I'll tell you the story of Brunia, the brawler. The real story.
There was a huge battle, right? His shrine had him in the middle, fighting off Aesir.
A pretty story, but no. Brungnir, you see, was born with neither head nor heart, so the giants had to complete him with stone. He was strong, to be sure, but also a perfect simpleton. Odin met him wandering in Midgard one day, found him so amusing, so harmless, so gullible, that he invites him back to his palace in Asgard. There he gives Brungnir his fill of mead, and goads him into all manner of boasts and antics, all for the amusement of the court. There. I saw the Aesir laugh as Hrungnir leapt upon his shield and swore he'd kill us all and take our womenfolk back to Jotunheim. Then Thor shows up. And does he laugh? Oh, no. Thor takes one look at the drunken stone buffoon and brings down Mjolnir on his head so hard that he's got chunks of Hrungnir in his own skull to this day. Thor is so startled by the faceful of rock, he doesn't notice Hrungnir's body topple right onto him with a sickening crunch. And again, the roars of laughter echo through the palace halls.
That's an awful story, Mimir. Nothing like the ones Mother told me.
Let that be a lesson, my son. Truth is... seldom so pretty as myth and legend.
switch over here.
Bothar. Frimund. Eric.